Harper Audio presents In Praise of Stay-at-Home Moms, written and read by Dr. Laura Schlessinger. Copyright 2009 by Dr. Laura Schlessinger. Production copyright 2009 by HarperCollins Publishers. Preface. With appropriate apologies to Shakespeare, I come to praise at-home moms, not to bury full-time working moms. This is not another missile attack in the mommy wars, nor is it a debate on daycare versus mommy care. This is also not a treatise on the benefits to children of being with a loving parent rather than with hired help or in an institutionalized group care setting. I will leave these arguments to wiser folks than I, and statistics and research results are generally appreciated only by those who wish to feel convinced or vindicated by them. I will admit, though, to being surprised, no, amazed, that a whole generation and a half of women have been so easily enraptured by the suggestion that what they have to give their child is easily replaced by a nanny, babysitter, or daycare worker. A baby is conceived in a woman's body, is nurtured there for 9 months, and then suckles at her breast, more aware of her voice than anyone else's in the universe. And then her arms, kisses, laughs, tickles, warmth, coos, and so forth can be substituted for with a routine of feeding, diapering, and snacks? Well, since so many people say it is so, I guess it must be so. Therefore, no argument from me. I am personally moved by and interested in the lovely stories of warmth, love, and sacrifice told by families who've structured themselves to focus on enjoying every possible moment of their child's journey and development. And I'm sure there are equivalent emotional highs from watching one's child's journey via nanny cams and daycare worker daily reports. I would never dream of telling a woman what she should do to make her life fulfilling, exciting, and purposeful. There are, of course, many ways to achieve personal satisfaction, and I would never dream of telling a woman that she is needed more by her family than anywhere else on the planet, because I wouldn't want her to suffer any guilt or sense of loss if she chose to be in a full-time career. I would never dream of telling a woman that the special sweetness and nurturance that only a woman can bring to a home might bring her a depth of joy and peace that she never imagined, because I might seem offensive to those women who don't, and I certainly don't want to offend anybody. No, I'm not here to condemn anyone for anything. I'm here only to let you know of the lives of families with at-home moms. I hope you will be touched, tickled, moved, and entertained by what follows. Introduction. Until I was 35, I never wanted to be a mother. At least that's what I thought, largely because of having been in the university during the 60s, when I was brainwashed, aka had my consciousness raised, into being a feminista for whom a career with its promise of personal importance, power, and success was what a real woman was supposed to aspire to. I knew for sure that I was definitely not going to become like my perpetually angry, frustrated mother, who always behaved as though being a wife and mother were tantamount to self-immolation, even though neither my dad nor circumstances ever kept her from doing anything she wanted to do. Nope. No little house on the prairie beginnings for me. The problem was, no matter how many successes I had, there was that constant something missing feeling. It didn't dawn on me that the empty feeling had to do with my uterus, breasts, and arms. I was clearly missing being a mommy. I woke up to that fact while watching a PBS Nova presentation on the miracle of life. Using fiber optics, they showed sperm swimming up through a woman's cervix into the uterus, where they made their way into the fallopian tube to meet the egg newly ejected by the ovary. The moment of fertilization was recorded, as was the embryo's trip down into the uterus to implant in the wall and continue development. The magical miracle of the whole subsequent 9 months of gestation was condensed into 60 incredible minutes. The final scene was the baby born vaginally and placed naked, wet, and surprised onto the mother's belly, while mom and dad cooed and whooped. By the tears on my face and the ache in my chest, I had found clarity as to what was missing. After a marriage, many infertility treatments, monthly disappointments, and one tubal pregnancy later, finally my quest ended in an emergency C-section, wherein a 9-pound son was delivered from his petite mom, and our lives were never the same again. The first 3 months were hell. Sleep deprivation and a constantly crying baby made me wonder what I had been thinking. My husband kept reminding me that this phase isn't permanent, but it was difficult to believe him. And then one day, exactly 3 months to the minute after his birth, our son slept through the night. As my mother had chosen to abandon both her then-adult daughters, I had no motherly advice or assistance. It doesn't matter how book-learned you are about children and parenting, when you're postpartum, all intellect evaporates, and you're simply an emotional heap of worry, self-doubt, confusion, fear, and exhaustion. The other problem for me was recovering from the C-section. We did hire a motherly woman for 2 weeks to come in and show me how to handle things, and she was a godsend. In the years before my son started kindergarten, we did try 2 preschool-like establishments to see if they had any benefit for him. One of them lasted 1 day. When I came at 4 p.m. to find that he hadn't stopped crying, that was the end of that. The headmistress gave me the usual argument that he needed to adjust, but I saw no reason to torture my child with my absence until he accepted his loss. The second time was when we were financially desperate, and I needed to do some part-time radio fill-in for some extra money to survive. At first, he liked the experience, but after a few weeks, the routine became boring, and he yearned to be with me, doing all the stuff we do in a day. Play, reading, errands, dancing, artwork, words and spelling, cycling, hiking, and so forth. So, that was the end of that. I am grateful for every moment I've had as a mommy. I have great memories of twirling my son around in a shopping cart in a local Target store parking lot, a lot cheaper than Magic Mountain, or of us walking through a forest pretending we were being tracked by monsters, selecting sticks for swords and spears, and working together to get to safety. And now, he's a paratrooper in the U.S. Army. My husband and I came to the practical conclusion that I needed to go back to radio work to be our family's primary financial support, while he would manage my career, the home, and our finances. Nonetheless, I refused to take any job that would require me to be out of the home every day while our son was at home or awake. I would take care of him all day and then go to work on radio, leaving the house at 9 p.m. after putting him to bed. Eventually, when he started kindergarten, I landed a daytime shift while he was in school. In order to do the writing and necessary research, I would get up at 5 a.m., and work a few hours before I woke him up to get ready for school. I always worked my career around my family, never the other way around. The first book I published, 10 Stupid Things Women Do to Mess Up Their Lives, required me to travel up and down the West Coast for interviews. I got all my son's teachers to give me his work for the week and took him with me. He did his work and had a blast traveling, meeting people, and keeping me company. He did cost my publisher a pretty penny, eating all the goodies in the minibar. Then I found out about satellite interviews. I could do 25 local and national television shows in one early morning session. I discovered I didn't have to leave home to promote my book. I have been attacked incessantly for supposed hypocrisy concerning this issue of childcare. I couldn't possibly have done all the things required of my career without neglecting my son, the argument goes. Well, those critics are just plain wrong and clearly defensive out of some well-earned guilt. It is so doable if you are committed to the priority of raising your children yourself, part of a marriage which obviously provides two parents, willing to sacrifice some opportunities for the sake of family, willing to do without many things but not family time and attention, and not willing to compromise on your conviction no matter how pressed you get by circumstances or naysayers. None of these efforts, I should say, guarantees that your kids will never be a pain in the butt or get into stupid situations. I will say, however, that your children are less likely to be major pains in the butt or get into horrendous situations. The closer the family and the more hands-on time spent with children, the more likely those children, as impulsive and impetuous as they normally are, will set some limits on their youthful experimentation and nonsense. Of course, it is also possible for a child brought up mostly in daycare or by nannies and or babysitters to be successful, personally and professionally. I wouldn't dream of suggesting that there are any real benefits to children from having at-home parents. It's just a choice, like French or vinaigrette dressing on your salad, isn't it? Well, sure, that's right. Because if you knew you were going to be recycled and come back as an infant with a choice, you'd choose a nanny, a babysitter, a daycare worker, or a mommy for yourself with equal enthusiasm. Right? There used to be a guilt factor about parenting your own kids versus paying someone else to. Guilt is not the motivator it used to be, as folks have shifted from should to feel like or not feel like. These days, the feely answer usually wins out. The freedom from responsibilities that don't lend immediate gratification, compensation, or glorification may be a surprise freedom from having deep meaning in one's life, but you can't have everything. During 2007, a spate of uber-feminist authors laid guilt on women who didn't abandon their children to other care, lest they do the universe and their children actual harm. No, I'm not kidding or exaggerating, by staying home with them. All the morning television talk shows glorified, in a largely one-sided manner, of course, the necessary course of action for a woman to avoid wasting herself in the mire of her children's needs and her husband's desires. That's when the feminist movement's mantra of choice got confusing. The decision to be a homemaker and full-time mother became a stupid, gross, dangerous error instead of a respected opportunity for self-expression and a deeper valuing of family life with regard to the well-being of a woman. However, in all fairness, that's why it's called the women's movement. It is for, by, and about the well-being of women, not children, not families. Wait, don't women benefit from the joy of motherhood and the bonding of marriage? I guess feminism does not see those as significant enough to warrant making the sacrifices necessary for the commitment to child-rearing and wifing. But, you know, I get so confused. I recently received an email from a young girl doing a pro-con report for school on daycare versus mother care. She wanted me to give her information, as arguments in favor of the mother care side seem difficult to find. What research could I give her that would not be vulnerable to dispute? I pondered that question for an entire morning. The answer came in the form of an email that arrived just before I turned on my microphone to do my daily radio show. And here it is. As I sit to write this letter, my hope is that if just one mother can hear what I have to say and holds her child just a little tighter today, I will have fulfilled my reason for writing. By the time I was 29, our family was complete. I had three beautiful children, a loving husband, and although never money to spare, we found ways to get by. I had stopped working full-time and started part-time shortly after my first child was born because I loved being with her. Although I had my mother and mother-in-law to babysit whenever I needed, by the time my middle son was born, I knew I could not work anymore. Something inside of me told me I had to spend as much time with my children as I could. My husband worked extra hours, I made do with what we had, and we made things work for us. My husband would work at night or at home, but if there was a baseball game, he was there. I cut everyone's hair, including my own, did my own nails, and never bought anything that was not on sale. And we were happy. There were many days where I was pulling out my hair, found myself screaming at them, was totally exhausted by the end of the day, thinking to myself, any other work would be a pleasant relief. But there were also many moments I could never trade in for any job, no matter what the pay. Those moments when your child gives you a smile or a look you never forget. Moments when they would give you a kiss, a hug, or just hold your hand for no reason. Those are the moments a mother treasures in her heart forever, and they can never be replaced, not even by a grandmother. I was selfish. I wanted my children to know me, and I wanted to be that special person in their lives. Although I didn't know it then, and on certain days may have told you otherwise, my life was perfect. Maybe life isn't meant to be lived perfectly. Maybe I took too many things for granted, but our life is no longer that perfect storybook tale. 2 years ago, my middle son was killed in an auto accident. He was 22 years old. He was away at college when he decided to get in a car where the driver had been drinking. 10 minutes later, he was dead. Our lives will never be the same again. The world as we knew it has been destroyed. We miss our son terribly. My husband's surviving two children and I will never be the same, but we're trying to hold on to each other and pick up the pieces one piece at a time. Dr. Laura, there is only one thing I can say. I am so grateful for those moments I had with my son. Those moments, the good as well as the crazy ones, I will forever hold close to my heart. All those precious years I spent with my son are now what helped me get through the day. So please, Dr. Laura, never stop preaching to all the young moms who feel they can't handle it, are struggling with making it through the day, who believe they need to work instead of being with their children, just how much it might someday mean to them to have spent those precious moments with their children. Hopefully other moms can just take my word for it. Don't let anyone or anything prevent you from holding them, hugging them, playing with them, memorizing their smile, their laughter, their heart. Our children are such special gifts that should never be taken for granted, and life is so unpredictable. We never know if today we will breathe our last breath. Lisa. As obviously touching and compelling as Lisa's letter is, I'm sure the uber feminists would recommend that the touching alternative would be to stockpile reports and videos taken by daycare workers, nannies, and babysitters, so that if the worst does happen and a child is lost, you still have those memories just through the eyes of other people. Close enough. This book is dedicated to the praise of at-home moms, from one mommy to so many others, affectionately. Dr. Laura Schlessinger, I am my kid's mom. Chapter 1, The Decision. There was a time long ago when parents agonized over the sad necessity of finding some sort of childcare due to deaths, financial disasters, and other catastrophes. Under these conditions, families often struggled with feelings of failure, guilt, and loss at having to outsource the warmth of parenting to hired help. The greatest generation isn't limited to those folks who served valiantly at war. It embraces the folks who worked on the farms and in the factories, toiling at difficult jobs to not only serve their country, but provide for their families. Little mentioned are the women who birthed their babies, raised their kids, and managed the home and the budget so that there would be food in the family's tummies and clothes on their back, taught their children right from wrong, made sure they washed behind their ears and got to school on time. In those days, there was very little belly aching about finding yourself, time for me, or what is my identity. Women were respected for their commitments and talents, and in spite of hardships, they felt important to their families and communities. Just in case you think this is all anachronistic, contemplate this recent letter from a listener. Quote, as I've been thinking and listening to your show, I've realized that our terminology surrounding women who choose to stay at home with their families has changed. We've become stay-at-home moms, or often negatively, housewives rather than homemakers. My suspicion is that women have coined themselves stay-at-home moms because they're wanting to be competitive with their working mother counterparts.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.